The health center is situated at the corner of the university behind the library. The cafeteria closes soon, but the snack machine is accessible throughout the night. We're constantly looking for ways to bring industry and agriculture closer together. The technician left the new microscope in the biology lab. Only those who are over 18 years of age are eligible to open a bank account in our bank.
And thanks for this opportunity to speak about Australia's engagement with Asia from the perspective of trade, and in particular to say a few words about what Austrade is doing in this space. I'm particularly pleased to be addressing trade and investment, not just, of course, because these two things are inextricably linked, but also, of course, because Austrade reports to Australia's first ever Minister for Trade and Investment. Asia's importance to Australia's economy is growing by the day. It is one of the most important factors to consider when assessing the international conditions for our national prosperity. Asian demand for our exports has helped Australia manage the global financial crisis better than most other developed economies, in fact, probably better than all other developed economies. And investment from Asia has added to the productive capacity of the economy and to overall productivity. In 2013, seven of our top 10 export markets were in Asia and represented 65% of our total exports. Asian markets and Australia's geographic proximity are critical, not just for our trade ties and our capacity to access important global supply chains, but also to the level of foreign investment in Australia. FDI has grown markedly in Australia over the past decade. In fact, it has more than doubled from about $292 billion to $630 billion in 2013.
Aquaculture, the farming of fish, shrimp, shellfish and seaweeds, has been the sources of human protein for nearly 4,000 years, especially in Asia. In the last decade, however, there has been unprecedented growth in aquaculture production, more than 300% since 1984, which has increased the importance of the modern food supply. It's the world's fastest growing food production activity. And globally, more than 25% of the cod fishing and shellfish production in 1999 was attributable to aquaculture. Yes, this industry's contributions to human diet is actually greater than the numbers imply, whereas one-third of the conventional fish catch is used to make fish meal and fish oil. Virtually all farmed fish are used as human food. Today, nearly one-third of fish consumed by human is the product of aquaculture, and that percentage will only increase as aquaculture expands the world's conventional fish catch, for the oceans and lakes continues to decline because of overfishing and environmental damage.
What is the habitat of camels? What instrument would you use to examine very small life forms?
What do you call the people who work for a company?
Which sense is related to your ears?
Well, nowadays, there's an increasing trend toward ecotourism holidays. So, what is ecotourism? Well, it's a form of tourism which should not only protect, but also actively improve our environment and its cultures. However, many forms of tourism which are presented as sustainable, nature-based, and environmentally friendly are often not what they seem, and this is rapidly becoming a somewhat thorny issue. Governments, as well as the tourism industry, promote ecotourism, but there are very well-founded concerns that in many instances, it not only lacks adequate scientific foundations, but is also not viable as a solution to the world's social and environmental problems, which, of course, is what ecotourism is supposed to be about. Many ecotourism holidays are really nothing more than a marketing ploy, and indeed, in the worst cases, can be said to even threaten local cultures, economies, and natural resource bases. The issue is further confused by the multitude of terms to describe types of travel which supposedly protect the environment. Other than ecotourism, we have adventure travel, sustainable tourism, responsible tourism, nature-based travel, green travel, and cultural tourism, to name just a few. So the problem we have here is whether a potential traveler who wants a legitimately environmentally friendly travel experience can make the right choice when confronted with this type of marketing.
In criminal trials, memories are basic, a critical feature of proceedings. Both sides of the legal team, prosecution and defense, are likely to rely to some extent on witnesses and on what they can recall of events that led up to or indeed formed part of the criminal act. Now, it's been well established in various circles that memory can be unreliable, particularly if new information is introduced in cross-examination that hasn't been presented up until that point. New facts that witnesses were unaware of. A lot of research has been done to test the effects of this, and it can be very problematic. For example, if you show a group of subjects a video of a crime, then you get someone else to read them an account of the same crime, but adding in information, be it ideas or objects that weren't present on the video. What researchers have found is that when the subjects are asked to retell what they saw on the video, they too include a number of things that were never there. In other words, the introduction of new information in a court of law is very likely to skew or distort a witness's memory of the event.
The professor is talking about clinical psychology.
In order to know how behavior patterns can be changed, the clinical psychologist has to know what causes the client to behave the way he or she does. Identifying the cause is called diagnosis. In diagnosis, a psychologist uses two basic tools, interviews and psychological tests. Through interviews and tests, the psychologist tries to classify the problem to see if it falls into any known categories. A psychologist may also attempt to describe the client's personality in terms of how he or she deals with life. For example, some people like to lead, and some prefer to follow the lead of others. Some people are active and outgoing, while others are quiet and reflective. In a diagnostic interview, the psychologist takes the client's case history. This means learning how the client got along with parents, teachers, and friends, as well as how the person handled difficult situations in the past. Psychological testing is the other way that a psychologist tries to diagnose the client's problems. Clinical psychologists have developed tests that can help them learn about a person's intelligence and personality, as well as tests that show whether a person's behavior or perception is influenced by emotions, disabilities, or other factors. Personality testing is useful in discovering how the client tries to adjust to life. Personality tests can reveal unconscious feelings the person is unable to talk about. This information can be important and could help shorten the length of treatment required.
Readjusting to life in your own country after living abroad for some time is a little like recovering from jet lag after a long flight across several time zones. It takes time. And research indicates that after 9 years of living in a foreign country, you never really do readjust. Of course, things have changed. Governments have come and gone. What you knew as countryside has become a suburb. New technologies have changed the way people go about their daily lives, and so on. These changes may well have been taking place in your adopted country, but they were happening while you were there, so you could adapt as you went along. Those are not the main difficulties, however. It is in the smaller, everyday things that you might experience what is known as culture shock, although it's not really a shock, but puzzling all the same. For example, the precise way to behave at a supermarket checkout may have changed. And in ordinary conversation, the frames of reference have changed. And quite often you find that you don't really know what people are talking about, even though they are speaking your native tongue.
In my opinion, Pocahontas was a spy for the colonists. Yes, she served as a mediator between the British colonists and the Native Americans, but she was more of a spy. As you know, she even provided vital food supplies to the colonists. However, she didn't think of herself as a spy, and the colonists didn't trust her much despite her help. In a way, we could say she was a sad spy. Unfortunately, a war broke out between the Powhatans and the colonists. The colonists captured her and brought her to Jamestown. While she was in Jamestown as a hostage, she freely converted to Christianity and married John Rolfe. As we all know, this marriage brought the war to its end. What do you think? Was she a mediator or a spy? I believe she was a spy who played a role as a mediator.
1. What role did Pocahontas play between the British colony and the Native Americans?
In 1963, Martin Luther King Jr. led a massive demonstration in Birmingham, Alabama. The protest was against racism in the United States. People, including children and teenagers, took to the streets to fight for their rights. However, tragically, police officers and firefighters tried to stop them with dogs and high-pressure water hoses. They were brutally attacked by dogs and torrents of water from fire hoses. These scenes were shown in newspapers and on televisions around the world. Of course, these scenes touched people's hearts, so the demonstrators gained support against segregation.
Did any of you notice those strange greenish-colored lights in the sky last night? Anybody? Mark?
I did, sir. They were beautiful. But, what were they?
We call them the Northern Lights, but they're also called auroras. There are two types of auroras, those in the Northern Hemisphere and those in the Southern Hemisphere. In the North, we call them the Aurora Borealis. In the South, they're the Aurora Australis. Auroras appear as colorful streams of light in the sky in high northern and southern latitudes. They frequently occur during the months before or after the equinox. The equinox happens in March and September. That's when the planet is tilted so that it's neither pointed away from nor toward the sun. So, why do auroras occur? They're the result of a reaction in the upper atmosphere. Solar winds hit the Earth's magnetic field. This may excite the oxygen and nitrogen atoms in the atmosphere. After some time, the atoms become relaxed. As they relax, the electrons in these atoms give off energy. This energy appears in the form of light. The color of the light depends on whether it comes from oxygen or nitrogen. In addition, the height in the atmosphere helps determine the colors that the light forms. Also, just so you know, oxygen usually emits a green or brownish-red light. Nitrogen typically gives off a red or blue light. Most auroras are green in color.
Earlier this year, I was driving through the countryside with a girl of six, and she pointed out some flowers by the wayside. I asked her what she thought flowers were for. She gave a very thoughtful answer. Two things, she said, to make the world pretty and to help the bees make honey for us. I thought that this was a very nice answer and I was very sorry to have to tell her that this wasn't beep. Finally, we take a look at how to mix and unmix liquids at the flick of a switch. Sandrine tells us more. Oil and water don't usually mix, but the new chemical sensitive to light has been added here to blend them together. When exposed to UV light, the chemical changes its structure and becomes soluble in water. This causes two layers to form with the oil floating on top of the water chemical combo. This method should be cheaper than the current alternative, which involves using high-energy centrifuges.
The ocean has been getting bluer, according to a study published in the journal Nature. But that's not really good news for the planet. It means that the plants that give the ocean its green tint aren't doing well. Scientists say that because the ocean has been getting warmer.
Although the original American Indian cultures were highly diverse, they were similar in many of their traditions. Religious beliefs and rituals permeated every aspect of Indian life. Southwest tribes such as the Hopi and the Apaches had a rich and elaborate year-round sequence of ceremonials including songs, dances, and poetry. The Hopi performed dances to bring rain. The Apaches engaged in special dances and ceremonies to gain the support of the spirits before undertaking raids or going into war. The Plains tribes often sought contact with the spirits by going on a vision quest.
Mechanical engineering has become predominant since the Industrial Revolution. Scientists were unsure when the early man left Africa. The capacity of programming computers is expanding enormously every year. The paper has the potential to transform life science.